we're going to discuss his growth strategy for his business and his motivation and also mindset. So I'm Maggie from Rock Paper Coffee, and let's begin. So Deepak, how are you doing?
Maggie, I'm excited that we're here. Really appreciate you reaching out, and just looking forward to hopefully answering your questions in a helpful way.
Thank you so much, Deepak. I really appreciate you spending this time with us today. So the first question, how do you motivate yourself to go after new goals after you reached a satisfactory income?
It's a really good question. I think that building scarcity into your life is very helpful with that. So what I mean practically by that is, I think as people, it is very easy or very possible to just really start coasting. You know, you get comfortable, you earn a little bit of money, you earn more money than you need, so then you can perhaps afford to actually save, and we all start feeling quite happy for ourselves, and maybe we've got to a place where, you know, the clients are good, the work is easy, we're not really learning and progressing, and all of a sudden you can find yourself in a space where things stagnate. And that, I think, is the biggest component of probably society today, that actually it isn't an extreme, whether it's extreme poverty or extreme success, that's the issue. It's everything that's in the middle. Because as you amazingly identified with your question, the easiest and most deadly path to take is that comes from, you know, the path of, let's call it, satisfactory income, or income that can just about meet all of your goals or meet all of your lifestyle needs. So one of the things that I've done to really ensure that I remain hungry is to just be pushing myself into new spaces. I always make sure that, you know, the company bank account is really on the lower side of actual, you know, a cash balance. I'll use that money for investment. I'll use that money for lots of other things. I'll use that money to put into rainy day funds, so that my checking account, when it comes to the end of the month or when it comes to other bills to be paid, there's always a little bit of a struggle, because I look at that account and it isn't that healthy because I put my money in other places. And the fear that that builds within me, Maggie, the fear that that drives, helps me grow. It always, always helps me grow. So I think that, you know, recognizing that we're fear-based, that it's our amygdala, that it's our mammalian brain that's the most powerful driver towards new actions, we need to encourage it. We need to build fear and build scarcity into our everyday lives to ensure that even if we're well beyond a satisfactory income, it will feel like we're still broke.
Oh my God, that is amazing. I've never heard this kind of approach before. I always thought that the scarcity feeling is something that I sort of passionately fear, and I never thought that you could actually use it to motivate yourself. So this is really eye-opening.
For me, I totally understand, and I just, if you look at basic human biology and you look at the fight or flight response and how our actual, you know, let's call them energy centers are composed, everything is based around extremes. It's extreme pain, extreme hardship, extreme circumstances that forces people to achieve new goals, or, you know, extreme talent or extreme success, name whatever it is. But if you're anywhere in the middle, then for much of the time that leads to complacency, it leads to stagnation, it leads to everything that probably ultimately over time does not look like success. So, you know, I think that if you can get into the habit of seeking out scarcity, that seeking out fear and learning to live with fear, learning to live with a little bit of uncomfortableness, it can help you drive and move forward into spaces that you have not yet been to.
Oh my goodness, that is amazing. Learning to live with fear, learning to live with being uncomfortable. This is so amazing. It just makes all this time so much worthy. Oh my God, I'm so grateful for that.
It's okay.
I'm so grateful for that. You are absolutely, this is eye-opening. Thank you so much for that.
you're welcome, Maggie. I'm really happy that it's helping. Thank you.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, so let's move on to the next question.
Yes.
If you have a client that are subscribed with you for packages that are that run for on a monthly basis, so for example, SEO packages,
yep.
How do you make sure that clients feel happy to stay with you for another month or another year? How do you make sure that they feel they get what they paid for?
I think that there's one of the biggest naiveties of service providers is assuming that what you offer today will still be good enough in 6 months from now. I mean, the reality is that when we pay for a service, when we pay for anything, when you pay for a handbag, whether you pay for a house, whoever keeps the same handbag for 6 months, whoever doesn't build their house, build new rooms, put in new wallpaper, put in new lights. And we have to, as service providers, think of our services being exactly the same thing. Because as great as your service might be, there's going to be someone like you, Maggie, who comes along, who offers faster, better, cheaper. And it really is faster, better, cheaper. And when you go into any engagement with that in mind, you have to continually seek ways, I think, to push the envelope. You have to find ways to evolve. And as much as there's an ethos about building systems, of course, that, you know, can scale and you can repeat with different clients, today the market is changing so fast that the presence of competition means that the actual state of service needs to be one of continual evolution. So I think that if clients see that you evolve, if they see that delivery continues to improve, they will naturally build relationships, loyalty, and allegiance with you for those times when there's maybe a problem with the delivery, or what you were doing for the last 2 months no longer applies to today, because you have took them from, you know, a amateur to a professional in the industry, and then going from professional to world class, as we know, is hard. And, you know, I think that when you become alive to the way that you make your own decisions, I'm going to install a new bathroom, I'm going to buy a new window frame for the bathroom, I'm going to repaint the house. Why should we expect anyone to be any different with, you know, the service that we provide? You're going to always look for something more. And if you can deliver and do that, then I think clients will invariably look and think that, you know, if I stick with Maggie, I think that she's going to continue bringing new stuff to me.
Okay, I see. So you mean update, I mean, keeping obviously your knowledge up to date and obviously pouring this knowledge into the client, saying, okay, so now I'm going to update this strategy that is, I mean, not no longer up to date, but I'm going to add new items to our strategy, so you know what's going to be done like next month and next month, to keep them excited.
Absolutely. I think you've got to keep people excited. I think you've got to give them, you know, not only the service you provide, but you have to over deliver. If you're going to deliver 4 phone calls, then you need to, you know, try and aim to deliver 10. And then when you deliver 10 phone calls, or, you know, in my case, an increase in organic traffic, you also have to make reporting as easy as possible. You need to make communications as slick as possible. And you just need to recognize that you have to look, smell, and feel so different from your competition. Everything about you has to be different. It's a little bit like a famous quote, Maggie, from 8 Mile, right? Have you seen the movie 8 Mile with Eminem?
I don't think I did. Unfortunately not.
It's okay.
I know you mentioned it on your website, yes.
Yeah. So in that movie, you know, Eminem gets into battle rapping, and there's the final scene at the end of the movie, and he's battle rapping a couple of these guys, and Eminem is from, you know, a trailer park, and he's this, you know, young trailer trash white individual, as he's called, and he gets into some of these battles, and there's a really, really interesting moment in the second battle when the guy comes in and again makes comments about, you know, the color of his skin, and again makes comments about where he's from, and Eminem says this one, for me, incredible incredibly powerful line B-Rabbit does in the movie, right, Maggie? He says, pay attention. You're saying the same shit that he said. And this is what almost every service provider does. We will offer you guaranteed results on Google. We will offer you an increase in traffic. We have case studies. We have testimonials. None of that is enough anymore, Maggie, because everyone's saying the same thing. And when you become, you know, aware of what your competition are saying, you have to seek ways to make your different value so clear, and you can't use the same language as the others. And all of these things really help clients stay with you longer, because then you begin to outline your value more, then you begin to look at the value that you provide, then you begin to over deliver, and then you start winning, and clients will invariably remain with you.
Okay, yes, I know what you mean. Sometimes when you visit different SEO expert websites, they tend to look the same, and they tend to use this kind of worn-out jargon that almost doesn't really make an impression on you anymore because everybody else is using it.
Exactly. You need to just make sure that you don't go with the flow.
Absolutely. I think you are doing a very good job, and all your branding is all around it, and I think it really reflects you as a person as well, because I've seen your personal website. So I think you're definitely doing a good job in implementing this strategy with your business.
Oh, and I could always do better. I'm trying, and you know, this conversation is almost as much for myself as it is for you. It reminds me, okay, Deepak, practice what you preach.
Oh yeah, it's often not the case, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, it's amazing that you still want to keep further, you know, keep going further and further and further. So this is something that we almost come back to the first point that we discussed. So yeah, that's amazing.
Thank you so much.
Okay, the last question, Deepak. Now, when it comes to mindset, it's important for you because mindset takes, I would say, 80-90% of my time, even when performing a business. It's important to you. Do you think it impacts your performance when it comes to your earning, your how you feel, and your relationships, and also, what are your strategies to keep the right mindset during a day?
It's a really, really good question, Maggie. I think that one of the critical things is, for me, exercise. I mean, exercise is absolutely huge, but again, it's exercise in a particular way. It's exercise that brings some level of almost fearfulness, discomfort, that actually ends in, bear with me one second, Maggie.
Yeah?
Sorry, Maggie, let me continue. I think that exercise has been huge for me. You know, one of the things that we're doing now as we grow the business is that I have partners, and as a consequence of that, I'm now, you know, I think on every Thursday, I'm going to be running 22 miles to basically my business partner's office to go and start my day. And
oh my God!
Yeah, and you know, it sounds crazy, and maybe it is, but you know, this is the thing. What happens? And this is, you know, taken from Les Brown, and it's I find it to be so true that the way you do one thing is the way you do everything.
Oh wow!
And
oh, wow.
You know, nothing. Let me repeat that just because it was amazing when I heard that and I thought about it, which is, you know, the way you do one thing tends to be the way you do everything, and it's true, isn't it? Right? You know, if you're sloppy if you're sloppy with exercise, you're probably sloppy with work. If you, you know, don't eat well, it impacts the way that you feel. If you train hard, you naturally want to eat better, and if you exercise, you have more energy. And you know, if you look at the constellation of things in your life, it's really just about, you know, being dedicated to, you know, upping a standard. And the simplest way for me to do it is through exercise. It's self-contained. It's very black and white in terms of the distance that you're going to, you know, go upon when you run. And it causes me to raise my standard with everything else that I do. And it makes the most powerful comparison point, because it's like, well, you know what? If I can run 22 miles before I start my work, then how can I ever complain about work?
Oh, that's an amazing attitude.
Yeah, I think that, you know, meditation or rather focus and mindset can take kind of many forms. And we as agency owners, as entrepreneurs, as even as human beings, I think it's, you know, having a commitment to being the best version of yourself, or being better than the person that you were yesterday, is hugely important. And for me, that as being part of a mindset is a must if you're going to reach or achieve any level of success. And you have to be unreasonable in your approach, right? Because a lot of people have a very, what I consider, naive expectation that if you do the right things, then you'll get the results. It's not true, right? You know, we build websites, we optimize the meta and title tags, we produce a long form podcast, a blog post, we maybe go on podcasts, we interview people, and you can still be broke, right? And it's in those moments where you're like, well, Deepak, I cold emailed 1,000 people, I cold called 100 people, I sent 100 LinkedIn messages, I still didn't get a client. It's then that you find out who you really are and what's really possible. And where do you build mindset like that? I build it, Maggie, by going out every week and doing these 22-mile runs.
Okay. I know that you have been running marathons, because 22 miles is almost a marathon, isn't it?
Yeah, that's correct.
So you're going to run marathon every Thursday. When do you start? Is it this Thursday?
I did my first one last week. I did about 17 miles. And then my friend Kaz, my partner and friend, surprised me by picking me up in his car whilst I was out running through the forest, which was quite funny. He just pulled up and there he was. So I'll be going again on Thursday morning. I'll leave my place about 6:30 a.m. and I'll be with him maybe 9:30, 10. I'll quickly change. We normally go to a cafe. I change in the bathroom and then we start working once I've had a coffee.
Wow, that's amazing. And it's a natural sort of energy boost for you, isn't it?
It is. It's something that's built up over time. My suggestion never is that someone wants to go out and do that. I mean, if you want to do it, you can definitely do it. But it's really just about, you know, mindset is a muscle. It isn't a one and done. It isn't, wow, Deepak, I heard your podcast with Maggie, or wow, Maggie, I heard your podcast with Deepak. I'm so motivated now. It's not enough. Mindset is like doing press-ups. You can do it for a month and get to 100 press-ups in one day. Then you cannot do it, and muscle atrophies, which means it decays four times as fast as you build it. So does your mindset. You have to consider it to be a continual commitment, because like exercise, mindset is something that will quickly erode away. So you need to have a daily commitment to building your mindset as well.
That is absolutely true. And I heard in one of the interviews, I think it was with Tony Robbins, when he said that, you know, anybody has got this kind of information how to change your life at the reach of their hand, because there's so many articles online, there's so many videos. But obviously it takes a practice, it takes someone to actually do it and do it over a long period of time. Because, you know, the mindset has been occupying me for the last, I don't know, a year, and beginning of last year, I have moved to Poland. Suddenly, the change of the location.
Yeah.
But I don't know, change of the location, change of the diet, because in Poland, the diet is quite heavy. And it definitely affected. I had so many negative thoughts.
Yeah.
And over the month, my actual income was reflected, because I had so many negative thoughts. I went almost broke. And then for the last few months, I was actually, you know, actively working on changing the mindset. And it's so difficult. As you say, it's a matter, it's not enough to do it one day. It improves over time, but it's a slow process. Just like building a muscle in the gym. Yeah, definitely.
Yep, absolutely. And I think that when people become aware that, you know, feed your mind, it is a muscle, feed it with good thoughts, good energy, good exercise, and also be patient. You have to do it for 90 days. Yeah, you can't just do it for a week and then expect you can undo, you know, months of difficulty or a lifetime of, you know, negative conditioning. We need to give it more time than we, you know, give and you see this in relationships. It's the same thing, and people forget that often, that, you know, one criticism can only be repaid by 1,000 compliments. And when you begin to understand that your mindset is the same, then you recognize that, hey, this isn't a quick win. This is my life.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for your time, Deepak. It was amazing to listen to you, to have a little bit of understanding about what motivates you and how do you stay in shape and how do you stay, you know, right in your mindset. I wish you so much best of luck with your business and best of luck on this coming Thursday when you will be running those 22 miles. I'll be with you in my thoughts.
Absolutely. Listen, Maggie, I had a really great time talking to you, and I think the questions were good, and, you know, I equally wish you well, and the fact that we're here and we're doing this, you know, speaks a lot about you. So it's been an honor and pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you so much, Deepak. Have a great day.
You too. All right. Bye.